A Maui instructor trainer. I have been for 25 years. I've been diving for 40 years. So I love to combine my diving with cinematography and sort of bringing my land lighting expertise into the underwater world. There's two aspects of this. There's sort of the wildlife aspect, which I love to shoot, and also shooting cinema work, which I do quite a bit of. So this is just a little underwater reel of mine, just to give you an idea of some of the things I do. There's no audio apparently, but. There is audio, really, but, oh, there we go. Okay. Thank you. I just dropped my love. See, I'm a cinematographer, not a sound guy. So, anyway, that's just a little taste of some of my work. There's some sort of wildlife stuff in there, and there's some professional cinema work. One of the things that I think gets forgotten about a lot of the time, where everybody's looking at kind of the technical side of cameras, what cameras we use, how we work on lighting and so on and so forth. But one of the number one skills we need to be an underwater cinematographer is diving skills. Way above and beyond what you would normally do to go and be a recreational scuba diver. So one of the things that's really, really important is buoyancy control and being able to hold a shot no matter what weird, strange body positions you'll end up getting yourself in to maintain that shot. I mean, you'll get into a position with a camera, this is heavy, where literally you're going to keep the camera in place and you're going to move all around that camera. That requires perfect buoyancy control and breath control. I can do a 3-foot camera move, boom move with just inhalation and exhalation, if I'm on regular scuba, that is. So one of the things to really, really do, I think, in both Paddy and Naui, give courses on precision buoyancy control. Go and do that. I also teach a professional cinematography course, which I have done for the last 5 or 6 years. It's sanctioned by Naui. And I do a whole pool session where we just work on buoyancy control skills and how to hold the camera. These are really, really important and critical to working in the water environment. Now, one of the things I think that people don't really understand is how optics change when you go underwater. As soon as you get like a dome port like this or a flat port, there is what's created a virtual image, greatly, much more so with the dome port. But let's talk about the flat port first. As you can see in the diagram, when light travels through water, it's refracted. So what happens when we're right here, here is where your actual object is, and due to refraction, the actual lens sees the object as close or it's magnified. This is sort of represented by when you put a pencil in the glass, you'll see the light does bend and refract. Now with a flat port, if you put a wide angle lens in a flat port, what's gonna happen, you're gonna find the center of the lens is sharp and the outside will become soft, and also you will get radial distortion. So flat ports, we wanna stay 55 millimeters or longer. And that's more for kind of macro work. There are some schools of thought that you use a flat port if you want to do a split surface to surface and underwater. The problem with that is you can put a wide angle lens in there and you'll see the object underwater is going to be magnified by about 25%. So you'll have a skinny person at the top and a really quite large person underwater. So now, well, some of the problems with this is with a dome port. Now, what's nice about a dome port, you put a 25 millimeter lens on there, you're going to see the field of view of a 25 millimeter lens. There's no magnification. But what you will do is you'll get a virtual image. So, for example, I'm getting my slides mixed up, guys, Okay. For example, so say infinity is on your lens is, say, 30 feet. Infinity is at 30 feet, represented by the red dot. What the dome port does, it now takes that 30 feet and brings it right in front of the lens. So now you've got a radius, that distance is approximately four times the radius of the dome. So say you've got an four inch radius, means infinity is actually gonna be at 16 inches. Why is this important? Close focus on the lens. 16 inches is infinity, so you've gotta be able to bring it in way closer. So maybe you're gonna probably wanna have a lens that's gonna focus down to at least 11 inches. Now, obviously, if we get into anamorphic glass where our close focus is 5 feet, then we've gotta start playing with diopters. So it is critical to understand this so that you can put the right lens on here and so forth. Now, this virtual image will vary depending on the size of the dome. So a larger dome is going to give you your virtual image is going to be further away. Now doing split, now because of this, now for example, your subject is 10 feet away, your lens on the surface, if you do a split surface shot, the top half is going to be 10, focus needs to be 10 feet, but underneath the focus may need to be 12 inches. So you can see there's gonna be a discrepancy with focus above water and below. But if you shoot a very wide angle lens at at a fat stop, that will eliminate some of this. Give me 1 second, I need water. Sorry, guys. So that will eliminate some of this. It can be tricky. So I usually like to use a 14 or a 16 millimeter lens and get really close. You don't want to shoot long lenses if you can help it, just because, you know, when you've got water between your subject and the lens, it's kind of like smoke. You know, water has particulate, especially in the ocean. So the further use of shooting long lenses is going to diffuse the image. You're better off coming closer than further away. So 25 millimeter lens, come in close. Don't put a 50 millimeter lens and pull back to get a close up. Okay. Okay, a little bit. Now, this is a project I did for the Olympics. I used 6 Blackmagic 12K cameras in Mark V Hydroflex housings. This is just a little bit BTS. There's no audio with this, but this was using Blackmagic 12K cameras and the Hydroflex housings. Okay, so you get the idea. I'm not going to play all this. So I had 6 12K Blackmagic cinema cameras. This was for shooting Caleb Dressel for Google AR for the Olympics. We had to have 6 cameras, all jammed, synced, and all measured and sort of overlapped to capture, exactly visual motion capture. Not motion capture, because for actual real motion capture, they're going to be wearing a motion capture suit, and it's actually going to capture in real time. Unfortunately, because of the distortion of water, it's going to give you a bunch of false readings for the motion capture. So basically, we're covering Caleb from below the water, from cameras both sides and cameras looking straight up, and they take those images and put them into the computer and use that as a bed for their motion capture. I know that James Cameron for the new Avatar film had a couple hundred mocap cameras which were specifically designed to capture mocap in water, but generally speaking, we're doing sort of an optical capture with those 12K cameras. Everything was shot 120 frames a second. I actually, to get those Ursa 12Ks into the Hydroflex housing, I had custom base plates made. This puts the 12K at ARRI center, and also on the backside, I also have ARRI offset so that I can use that in the Hydroflex multiplied housing. you know, Pete Romano, who owns Hydroflex, is obviously a legendary underwater cinematographer. And that Mark V housing with the 12K is a really great combination. You can run your Preston remote to the surface, and so you have focus control from the surface. You can even run power for them from the surface if need be. So you can run power feeds directly from the surface or with onboard batteries inside the cameras. Now, the great thing about the big Hydroflex housing, it's heavy. It's probably 90 pounds out of the water with, say, a standard Arri Alexa inside of it. Makes it incredibly stable, all that inertia. When you're holding that camera, to make it shake is really hard work, right? You've got all this mass in the water, so it is actually easier to operate than, say, cameras like this, or even especially a really small housing like this. The important thing is, though, with those really big housings and with these housings, is camera trim. So with the, you know, the Hydroflex Mark V housing, there's trim weights on it. There's trim weights that it comes with. When you go to Hydroflex and prep it, you can actually put it in a tank they have there and get the whole thing trimmed and balanced, which is basically meaning I let go of the camera underwater, it'll just sit there. It doesn't tilt down, it doesn't tilt up, it doesn't sink, it doesn't float. It's completely neutrally buoyant. And that way, when you're pushing that camera through the water, you have to exert very little energy, in as much as I'm not tilting it up or trying to lift it. All I'm doing is framing with the camera very gently, sort of like a Steadicam. I mean, I'd hold this housing when it's properly trimmed underwater more like you'd hold the post on a Steadicam. It's very gentle. If I'm hanging onto it for dear life, every fin kick, every body movement will transmit through the camera. So that's the Hydroflex Mark V. You know, we also shoot a lot. I have an Alexa Mini housing, which is a Nauticam housing. I haven't got it here today. It was actually, I had it in Texas on a job, and half of it disappeared on the FedEx truck on the way back due to Hurricane Ida. So hopefully I'll get that back soon. These two housings I have here are actually three. This is my own, this is my Blackmagic Pocket Cinema 4K housing. I love this little housing here. I've actually shot professional work on it. Now this is my 6K Blackmagic Cinema camera housing. This I really love. I can shoot professional work on this and do quite often. You know, there's a lot of jobs where they don't want to buy an Alexa or a big camera and hire an assistant today to prep it all. You know, they got one shot, somebody's jumping in a pool, or, you know, there's a lot of those sort of jobs where there's one or two shots, and, you know, spending a whole bunch more money, you know, $4,000 or $5,000 a day to hire, you know, a big housing when I can do it on this. This performs at 6K housing. This is a HDMI out. But what I do, I put a monitor on here, a Ninja Atmos housing on here, Ninja. I can come out of there, I can plug the HDMI into the monitor, and then I can output SDI, and then I can send an SDI to the surface for the client to view. So what gets tricky about this is once you get a monitor on here and, you know, you've got a big dome port, it's a 230mm dome on here. A couple of things happen. One, first thing, it does this, tilts up at the front, and then so I can put ankle weights around the dome port here to bring it back down, and now it becomes negatively buoyant. So that's when I'll actually put large float arms right off the side as floats to offset that negative buoyancy. It's even more crucial with these small housings to get these trimmed, because if you've got to put energy into tilting this thing down or lifting it up, there's not the inertia you've got with a big Hydroflex Mark V housing. These are really, really lightweight, and, you know, I can pick them up here without any effort at all. So trimming them is really, really critical. You know, you have zoom and focus gears on the side here, run stop here. I'm using actually a Sigma 14 to 24 lens on this. I'm gonna pull this off here real quick. You know, these are all these, you know, the Blackmagic cinema cameras are all EF mount. So my two Land 6Ks I've actually modified to PL, these I keep EF because the gearing, all the gearing for focus and zoom, etc., is built for EF lenses. And I basically have two lenses for this. I have the 14 to 24, and then I have the 18 to 35 Sigma art lenses, which I use. They're really, really sharp. And sometimes on land, I may not want something that sharp, but underwater, with all that water in between, having a really sharp lens is good. They're also really fast, which is nice. So they give me great images. And I use, on the 4K, I use a 7 to 14 Olympus Pro, because Sigma don't make anything for in MFT in Micro Four Thirds. This little camera over here, you know, this this is here courtesy of Hollywood Divers, which is the shop I actually teach out of and have a fabulous underwater camera rental department. But this little setup here is Sony RX 100 Mark VII. With the Nauticam wide wet lens. What's cool of that, those of you who saw my octopus teacher, Craig Poster, this was the camera he was using. There was a secondary underwater camera team on that, but Craig Poster's own camera, which he used a lot in his interaction with the octopus, was shot right off this camera in this setup with this wide wet lens. It's a zoom through optic, and it's really, really sharp. And I have to say, for a very inexpensive underwater package, this is a great thing to have, even though the only thing against it, it's really negatively buoyant. So you've really got to put some work in to get it trimmed out properly. As you can see, that's a Hydroflex Mark V housing, properly trimmed. I'm in Acton Scuba. It's a tank out in Acton, which is actually built for shooting. But this is shot out at Catalina and a couple other places on the Pocket Cinema 4K. This housing right here with the Blackmagic cinema camera in it. It's pretty great. If I can actually make it play, that would be even better. All right. As you can see, for a small camera, the quality of those images is pretty impressive. Those big fish are giant black sea bass. If you've ever been to Catalina, those are in the dive park right off the casino. Those guys get 600-700 pounds. There were some really big fish there. The heads are probably around this wide. So getting up and close with those guys is a lot of fun. They're like giant cows. They're not in the least bit scary. But the point is that, you know, even for a small camera like this, you can get really, really fantastic images. So 6K, and then we get into the 12K or the ARRI cameras. I know a lot of I'm not a big Red fan, but that's just me. I know that a lot of the professional Nat Geo guys use Red cameras with the Gates housings, because the Gates housing will take multiple types of Red cameras, and it's sort of become a thing with the Nat Geo guys, plus the high resolution at, and high frame rates. My personal choices are definitely, I do stick with ARRI or Blackmagic 12Ks or 6Ks when I'm doing professional works. This setup I actually use a hell of a lot. And for the investment, it's really great. And, you know, I can rent this whole package for $1,000 a day. You're probably at the end of the day, by the time you've got the dome and everything, into $5,000, you're probably $8,000-$9,000 at the end of the day with cameras, lenses, ports, and so on. But you know, you're going to earn that back really quickly. What's great about this housing too is, I know everybody knows, the battery life is kind of tough on these cameras. Well, if you look in the back here, hang on, we actually has four 3,500 milliamp hour 18650s. Literally, I can pretty much shoot all day. It's just hard power. I can pretty much spend a day of diving in the ocean with these, and I can shoot a 12-hour shoot day on two sets of these batteries in the camera and have that camera on all day long. So, you know, that doesn't become a problem. You can also, you know, these cameras take CFast 2 cards, but also there's a slot in the top of the housing here for you to put in a Samsung T5 drive, which will actually capture a little higher data rate than the CFast 2 cards. Same goes with the 4K. So you've got options on data management. It's a pretty sweet setup, actually. You know, big 5-inch monitor. Unless I'm doing a job where I'm actually needing to send a feed to the surface, if they're just going to let me shoot and look afterwards, I don't even bother putting a monitor on here. This monitor on the back is more than enough. You know, for focus, they use the focus assist set to high on green on these cameras. For underwater work, and honestly, I'll just grab my first focus of infinity with the automatic focus on the camera, and then I'll just dial the focus in after that. It's pretty simple to use, and you don't need a first AC, and you've got something that you can shoot professional grade work at 6K. You know, up to 50 frames. If you want a higher frame rate, I usually go down to 2.7K with it. I'm still getting a beautiful image, and you know, I love these cameras a lot. Professional work. Now, this little baby, as I said before, is really a nice little, if you want something that's easy to use, give really great images, and you're doing, you know, you're just more of a want to do this for just for a hobby, this is pretty damn awesome. And the fact that it's so small, you can literally put it in a carry-on bag and you're not humping a load of heavy bags around. It's really small, it's really compact, and takes really beautiful, beautiful images. I'm going to show you one more spot, and I'm the sort of guy that likes to answer questions, and I will be much more responsive in questions. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to show you one more spot. I'm going to talk a little bit about the spot because it was kind of a little conundrum that occurred, but I'm just going to show you the spot, and then I will talk about it.
Organic, intuitive, fluid. Neuromorphic computing is designed to work less like today's microprocessors and more like the human mind. Because brains are so different than transistor circuits, we have to rethink everything we know about computer architecture. Traditional microprocessors are synchronous, meaning every function is governed by a clock. The clock says when instructions are executed and when functions happen. Everything works in unison, according to the clock. Our brains are different. They're asynchronous, meaning no internal clock. Neurons operate with no prescribed order. We just have thoughts. Thoughts that build on each other or split off into different ideas. That's the way neuromorphic computing works too. It's completely asynchronous. So functions and instructions happen when they happen in parallel, which means neuromorphic systems think more like brains do. They can adapt, recognize nuances, and teach themselves as they work. It's an elegant, organic, and beautiful way to think.
Okay, there's a funny story behind this. Happy accident. I was not the DP on the land work. I was the underwater DP. You saw those overhead shots of the synchronized swimmers on the surface. They decided they wanted to throw a black on the bottom of the pool, and I'd said, you know, you should order underwater blacks, blah, blah, blah. Get to the chute, and they've got a 20 by ultra bounce black side up laying on the bottom of the pool. Kind of a huge mistake. As you can see, the water's fairly milky. All the white off that ultra bounce starts coming off and turns the water milky. And initially, I had a little bit of a concern about that because I wanted, you know, crystal clear water for this to occur. But as you can see, it was sort of, it was like adding light smoke to the water and created lots of like really probably more shafts than you would normally get. So it was kind of an happy accident, but it's also a really good lesson to not throw an ultra bounce in the water for a black if you want to shoot underwater. It the white comes off of it underwater, which is a lesson I learned as well on there. But normally I would use underwater blacks. We do have underwater blacks for shooting underwater green screens. They're made to go in the water. When we're working in the water, we really want to keep it clean and clear, unless, of course, there's some reason like we're supposed to be in a murky lake and digging someone out of a car or finding a dead body, whatever that is. But generally, you're going to start with always want to start with clear water. Things that can go wrong very quickly, like when you're putting blacks in the water, you've got to sandbag everything down. You don't want to use lead shot bags. You don't want to use sandbags, obviously. You want to use bags with stainless steel bags because, you know, sandbags and lead will both cloud the water. You want to make sure every piece of gear is hosed and rinsed off before it goes in the water. We are going to use underwater lights, and certainly when you get your underwater lighting gear from Hydroflex, their gear is all properly prepped, so you can put that right in the water. But sometimes in transportation, it gets dirt on it. You want to just hose all that stuff down. Obviously, if we're putting lights in the water as well, you want to make sure nobody's going to get electrocuted. one of the things that you always, if you're going in as an underwater DP on a job, many producers are not familiar, necessarily familiar with underwater shooting protocols and some of the safety aspects of it. And one of the big ones is making sure that any power, any network near the water, whether the lights go in the water or whether it's equipment around the water, everything needs to be on the GFI or shock blocks. Now, sorry? Shock blocks, yeah. They're or GFI, ground port interrupters, right? There's a company, Hydroflex, will provide a lamp-by-lamp shock blocks, but you can also get, bring in 400 amp. There's 400 amp GFIs and so forth and larger, where you can actually tie all the power straight out of the generator through the shock blocks and distribute power around the pool or the water area which you're working in. Really important that you guys check that out and confirm that before you get in the water. I've seen, shock box there and then somebody else has run a banded whip out of the back of the generator and it's not GFI'd at all. So, I always have the GAF or Best Boy Electric walk me around the entire cable runs and back to where the shock box are just to confirm everything's safe. I'm the one going in the water and you'll be the one going in the water. So you want to look out for that kind of stuff. Obviously water safety is important. If you're working on a professional set, there are some sort of regulations we have as far as safety goes. When I'm in the water, I always have a safety guy with me. Even in a tank, believe it or not, I've had, if you've got a lot of sets in the water or equipment and a piece of equipment comes over and you get trapped, having a safety diver there is kind of crucial. Now, every single talent you have in the water, in most cases, not all cases, you want to have one safety diver per talent. Now, you saw the synchronized swimmers there, and there's some, in my earlier video, there was also some synchronized swimmers I work with. They're like the Aqualilies. Those guys, we'll have one or two, there may be five or six of them in the water, and we'll only have a couple of safety divers in because actually they can swim better than we can. They'll hover upside down all day long and not have a problem. But safety divers are really important. Having an underwater crew that knows how to work underwater, being scuba certified does not mean that you know how to work underwater. I normally tell assistant directors, another thing, time. Speaking of working underwater, however long it's going to take you to do a setup on land, chances are it's going to take you 3 to 4 times as long to do underwater. So lots of times when a job is scheduling a day, especially when they only have one section of underwater work, they tend to schedule it very similarly to they do on land. So you kind of got to let them know. Sometimes they'll adjust and sometimes they won't, but at least you've got to let them know and say, you know what, this is going to take X amount of time, not the amount of time you've got slotted. And sometimes that will come down to you compromising safety, right? Do not compromise safety. I actually just got a call yesterday from a sheriff dive team in San Diego about an accident on a film set and about safety protocols. And really, the accident, somebody died, and the accident occurred due to the fact that the right safety protocols weren't in place, and people were trying to do too quickly. Everybody was in a rush, and it cost someone's life. So it sounds silly. I'm in a swimming pool, but you know what? People drown in 3 feet of water, and things can go wrong really, really quickly. So do not underestimate water when you're in it and working in it, especially when you're working in it. Another thing with water is I'm going to drink some. The ocean. Now, certainly when you're working in the ocean, you want to make sure you have a really good marine coordinator. Marine coordinator is basically oversees safety and all the logistics of working on water in the ocean. I did a underwater sequence on a Bad Bunny video last year with, I had a submarine underwater. I'm shooting a submarine. And it was sort of, there was a lot involved. We had camera decks and all sorts of stuff out in around Catalina Island. You know, Matt O'Connor is a marine coordinator that I work with a lot. He's just finished up the Avatar films with James Cameron. He's actually in Thailand doing the cave diving rescue movie right now. But, you know, that guy, I completely can trust with my life in all these, in any situation. And he always has a team of divers in the water that he trusts and will have your back and really understand what's going on in the ocean. Obviously, when you're in the ocean, everything becomes much more critical. We're not in a confined water environment. We're in ocean. I mean, we were in about 60 feet of water when we were shooting these submarines, and I was shooting 35 millimeter film. So that adds another layer of complexity to things. So safety is really important. And you know, sometimes there's an error, but you know, you feel pressured by producers to cut corners. And obviously we all want to continue to be employed and we don't want to burn bridges, but honestly, you cannot cut corners with safety, especially working in the water environment. What I'd like to do, I do really good with answering people's questions and I get off on tangents. So if anybody would like to ask some questions, there's a mic on each side. If you would like to walk up to the microphone and address me with a question, I would be more than happy to answer it. John.
I have a question for you. Can you talk a little bit about the difference between a rebreather and not rebreather in shooting and how you actually do buoyancy control with a rebreather?
Oh, okay. That's interesting. Rebreathers. Why do we use rebreathers? We use rebreathers because we can spend more time deep and we have no bubbles. We're breathing warm, moist gas as opposed to cold, dry air. Regular scuba, you have a cylinder on your back, a tank on your back, and you're inhaling air, and you're processing about 14 to 15% of the oxygen in that air, and then you're exhaling that out into the ocean. And it's also cold and dry because as air expands, it's in a tank at 3,000 psi. Intermediate pressure on a scuba cylinder tank is 140 psi. So the first stage takes that 3,000 psi and then it expands and drops down to 140 psi. That cools the air, so the air is cold, number one. Number two, it's extremely dry because the compressors have to have very, very dry air because you don't want to corrode the inside of your steel or the tank. So it's very, very cold and dry. As we inhale, our lungs expand, we increase our volume. That's why we can do a 3-foot move when we're neutrally buoyant. As we inhale, as we exhale, we sink. So we're up and down and up and down. Go to a rebreather. A rebreather has a counter lung. So as you inhale, your lungs fill up, the counter lung collapses, volume doesn't change. So therefore you don't rise up and sink down with a rebreather. The other thing, because you're cleaning the carbon dioxide out of the breathing loop through a scrubber material, it's basically It looks a lot like kitty litter. It absorbs carbon dioxide. So as you exhale, it goes through the carbon dioxide into the counter lung, which is now full up because you've exhaled. Oxygen sensors are calculating how much oxygen was actually used and injecting oxygen back into the breathing loop, and so the cycle continues. That process of carbon dioxide scrubbing creates condensation and heat. So now you're breathing warm, moist gas, which is really nice. You don't get as cold because now you're getting warm, moist gas into your body. The other cool thing about rebreather, no bubbles. So if you're shooting wildlife, especially like hammerhead shark, scallop-nosed hammerheads especially, say you're in the Cocos Islands with hammerhead sharks, whales, whale sharks, things like that, no bubbles, you'll be able to get really close. Bubbles scare a lot of animals away. So really wonderful things to dive in a rebreather. Sort of the rebreather of now is a rebreather called a Revo. It's a titanium steel frame. It's pretty lightweight, but it's got 5 oxygen sensors, 2 CO2 scrubbers. It's very, very safe as far as rebreathers go. Rebreathers can kill you very quickly, but the Revo is one that actually has got a lot of redundancy in it, which makes it a considerable bit safer than a lot of rebreathers out there. Yeah, of course, now you can't control your position in the water column with your breaths as much. You now have to have really, really fine-tuned buoyancy control to make sure you stay in the right place in the water column, because you can't, sometimes, you know, if you feel yourself rising on regular scuba, you just exhale and you'll drop back down. You feel yourself rising on that, you got to dump that air out of the buoyancy compensator really fast. That enough? That answer the question? Yep.
First of all, I wanted to say I really enjoyed you on the Underwater podcast.
Oh, thank you.
So, start with that. What advice would you give aspiring young underwater DPs starting out and trying to broach the business?
Shoot, and any, whether it's one of these cameras or another camera system, Sony A7, you really just got to go in the water and set up things and shoot it. You know, Brett Stanley, still photographer, really good still photographer who does the underwater podcast, he's got a pool in his backyard, or have a friend's pool, and go shoot stuff. You know, set things up and shoot it. I mean, really, that's, I mean, I got into it. I mean, I was I've been a director of photography for 35 years on land. It took me years to actually be able to transition to underwater. It's a very niche world, and a lot of it's networking, you know. I post like crazy on Instagram, to the point, funnily enough, I stated this the other day, people all of a sudden think, oh, you're only doing underwater now. Well, I still keep pounding away at that. I mean, it's a pretty niche, and there's guys like Pete Romano and Ian Takahashi who are, you know, they're really amazing underwater cinematographers, and there's other guys out there as well. So it's a really niche market, and there's only so much work, and, you know, I take it when I can. And you know, if you can find projects, do stuff for free, you know, and practice. That buoyancy control, I'm telling you, that will make you a break. If you can't hold that shot, and sometimes you're twisting around that camera like you're going to be standing on your head, but you got to hold the shot. So just practice, honestly, and shoot stuff, post it, talk about it, tell people you want to do it, and be excited about it. And that's the best. That's about the best answer I can give you, because that's kind of what I did.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Hi. Yeah. Hi. I have a few about the things that you were speaking. I have so many questions. One of them being lighting. What could you tell us a bit more about, like, all the reflections and then preparing for what works
lighting
best?
Underwater?
Lighting. Yeah. And then lighting combined with green screen.
Ah, okay.
And then other thing that was I was very curious if you could talk more about, it was the process of multi-camera that you used for the Olympics, and how was that, the whole thing with reflections and having, you know?
Okay, right. A couple of things there, okay. Underwater lighting. Water eats light, so, you know, water, narrow beam will get very wide very quickly. So where I'd use a 2K on the surface, I'd use a 4K underwater, you know. When the water's above the water, especially this why we shoot in the ocean in the middle of the day, when the sun is out directly overhead, you're going to get the most light and the most even light. The lower the sun gets, it skips off the water, the surface of the water. So a couple of things it does in the ocean, if the sun's over here and you're looking this way, now you've got backlit water, it looks like a dense smoke, right? So I try and shoot in the water in the middle of the day. Underwater green screen, the last big underwater green screen job I did, I had Hydroflex have 8K underwater cyclites, HMI cyclites. So you use a underwater green screen. You know, last one I had was a 75 by 20. And they're basically cyclites with a parabolic reflector. There are two 4K bulbs in each unit. He also has either green screen or blue screen shells for them to hide them if you need to hide them. Mm-hmm. So now we're doing regular underwater lighting from the ground, just like green screen. You know, I try and put a bit of backlight in there, create a little separation. And then I'll maybe an M90, Arri M90 on the top, where I'll have high up above, slightly behind. I don't like to get it too steep because I lose a lot of heat that way. So this time I keep it fairly steep so that I get a nice wrap on the hair light and it feels really natural. Mm-hmm. When I can, a lot of what you do, you're trying to recreate. I have a movie, I'm shooting a thing for a movie, Julio McCat is shooting later in the month, actually next month. And the scene, and somebody jumps off a bridge and lands in the water. And there's a whole sequence of stuff happens underwater. But you want it to feel, it's cutting from daytime in a real location into a tank. So we black out the tank, mm-hmm. right? Truss rig overhead, two Arri S360s over the top, skylight. Then an M90 for the sun overhead to recreate that feeling of daytime. I put no light underwater, you know. I'll just let it be what it is. Sometimes I'll even have somebody have a whiteboard and on a diver just to pick up some of that top light just for a little fill. But otherwise, I'd want it to feel really natural. Yeah. So when you do lighting, underwater, and it's supposed to represent, you know, being in the ocean or in a lake or whatever, really think about how that light really